Hello, and welcome back to In His Image with the Sisters of Life. My name is Mother Agnes Mary, and I serve as the Superior General of the Community of Sisters of Life. I'm joined today by Sister Veronica Mary and by Jennifer, and we're here in our mother house in Suffern, New York. Over the second part of this two-part series, it will be our joy to share with you a little about our missions. Today, we're speaking of our mission of hope and healing after abortion. Abortion has affected so many women, as we all know, and men across our nation and world. In New York State alone, one out of three pregnancies ends in abortion. Can you speak, Sister Veronica, about how abortion affects women in your experience?
Yes, I'm happy to. In our experience, often women who call us share their experience that they feel that they've committed the unforgivable sin. Mm-hmm. And that often feel filled with feelings of shame and guilt and remorse. Mm-hmm. And they often feel God is angry with them. And so that often leads them to do a U-turn from God, a U-turn from the church and the sacraments. And so this feeling that God is angry with them makes them feel that they don't deserve anything good, and that they deserve to be punished. And so this often leads them onto a path of self-destructive behavior and poor choices in relationships and often marriage. And they say this can go on sometimes for years and even decades.
Can you speak a little, Sister Veronica, about our mission of walking with women into the heart of mercy, the mercy of Jesus Christ?
Absolutely. This is our great joy. As sisters, you know, we feel it is our privilege to be instruments of God's mercy. And to say, I think, what Jesus would want to say to every woman who calls, and that is, no sin is greater than my mercy. Yeah. And so working with that in the center of our hearts, we provide a safe, a confidential, a welcoming voice on the other end of a phone call or at the other end of an email, a great source of encouragement. And that is an invitation by God, really, to come and know that there's not only hope, but there's a lot of hope. And that's what it means to be Christian, really. And so to be instruments of hope, at the end of a phone call, sometimes there's a face-to-face meeting. Conversations can go on sometimes for weeks. We offer days of prayer and healing. We accompany women, which means we're supporting them. We're encouraging them at their pace. We go where they're at, because their story is unique and their needs are unique. And so we're happy to just kind of be there with them, in spiritually pointing them, supporting them, validating them, because the world isn't going to often validate those feelings that they share with us. And so relationships develop, and this can go on for quite some time, as long as it's helpful and that they need us, and we're happy to be there for them.
Jennifer, would you be able to share a little of your own story with those who are listening?
Oh, yes, Mother. Wow, so when I was 18 years old and a senior in high school, I became involved with a boy who was 21 years old, and 6 months into that relationship, I became pregnant. The only option he offered me at that time was not marriage, but abortion. So at the age of 18, I had my first abortion. I remained with him, and at the age of 22, while I was working my first full-time job, I became pregnant again, and I thought that this time would be different. But again, the only option that he could offer me was not marriage, was abortion. And so I had my second abortion at 22. Both times, I never reached out to any adult or any family member, so I isolated myself. I was alone, and it changed me. I could never put a finger on it, but something inside deeply changed. I ended up marrying him a few years later. But we divorced 4 years later. I pushed him out of my life. It was as if I pushed him away, and I was pushing away that whole part of my life. I became like an animal that had been wounded. I was thrashing out, and I became very selfish. And I suffered. And I suffered from anxiety and fear and restlessness. And I didn't know what was bothering me. I could never pinpoint it, but I knew something was wrong. And I also would defend. I would defend abortion with anger. But my heart would cry. And so there was this disconnect between what my heart said and what my head said. Mm-hmm. I had to defend it. How else? Look what I done. Mm-hmm. I avoided confession. I avoided God. Mm-hmm. I avoided the church. If God could have forgiven me for the first one, he certainly couldn't have for the second one. And I suffered greatly for 29 years. Mm-hmm. Even the word abortion would make the blood rush out of my head. After 29 years, my current husband, a very good and holy man, was being drawn back to the Catholic Church, and he invited me to join him. So with his openness to God, to say yes, it brought me smack dab in front of my two abortions. I couldn't abort it now. So I clawed my way to my first abortion, my first confession, 29 years. Mm-hmm. It was the hardest thing I had to do. And I made a tearful confession to a priest who was wonderful and guided me so graciously, so gently through the whole process. Mm-hmm. And he granted me absolution. And he told me I was a lost lamb that had found its home. Mm-hmm. And he said, "Welcome home, little lamb." And he told me, "But you need healing. And you have a story that needs to be told. And there's the Sisters of Life, and that's all they do. They help women like you." Yeah. I fell in love with a God that day that I never knew existed. Mm-hmm. I had been running away from God mm-hmm. my whole life. Mm-hmm. And there he was, open arms, forgiving. After a few months, I reached out to the Sisters of Life. I couldn't say the word abortion, so yeah. I typed it. Mm. And I went on my first day of prayer and healing. And I discovered at that day what it was mm-hmm. that had been bothering me for 29 years, that I could never put my finger on it. Mm. And that was 2011. And my healing journey has only brought me closer and closer to God, and further from that woman that I was all those years ago. Yeah.
Well, I've only known this one, and who I think is in the image of the one who created you. As we close this segment, what would you say to a woman who has suffered an abortion? What would your words be?
Well, you can see it in Jennifer. I would say you have no idea how much God loves you.
Yeah.
How much he desires more than you do, your freedom.
Yes.
For you to experience peace. Mm-hmm. All the things that have evaded you yes. are there for you, and God wants mm-hmm. you to have that fullness. Mm-hmm. So don't wait. We're nice people. We won't judge you. Pick up the phone, uh-huh. send an email,
yeah.
and begin the journey.
It doesn't matter how many abortions you've had. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter how many years or decades it's been. Mm-hmm. This is not an accident that you're here. This is your appointment. God's already here. It's come to the well and come to healing.
Thank you. Thank you both. And join us next for a look at our missions of retreats. Welcome back to In His Image with the Sisters of Life. I'm here with Sister Pia Jude and with Aurelie, who have each experienced our retreat mission mm-hmm. in different ways. Sister Pia Jude, can you tell us a little, or tell the listeners a little about our retreat mission?
Of course. Actually, it's one of my favorite missions that mm-hmm. we have. And it was Cardinal O'Connor, our founder's dream. Mm-hmm. And he would say to invite people to come in from out of the rain, mm-hmm. to restore, to renew, to refresh. And this dream became possible when the Knights of Columbus invited us to run retreats out of a gorgeous retreat house in Stamford, Connecticut, Villa Maria Guadalupe, which has now been home to thousands of men and women mm-hmm. who have passed through these doors, young, old, coming on retreat with us to experience and encounter the living God, mm-hmm. Jesus, who yes. is so present when we make an intentional act to take out that time, that weekend of His, mm-hmm. and to just allow ourselves to be loved back to life. Mm-hmm. And it's been a gift to see the sisters pour themselves out in being those instruments in loving mm-hmm. Men and women back to life. And I'm just so grateful and blessed to have witnessed that and to see it spread. Now we also have retreats up in Toronto. We have retreats primarily for college students out in Denver. And so this ministry is just, people are hungry for it. You know, mm-hmm. people are hungry.
Mm-hmm. It is wonderful. It sounds like, you know, as you speak, that it's likely that retreats, and we certainly know this from the testimonies of those who have been on retreats, how powerful a retreat experience can be. Mm-hmm. Orly, I know you've told your story to us before, but yeah. I think it would be wonderful for others to hear how your life was changed, really, by putting aside time for God.
Well, Sister used the word that I like to use when describing what retreats have been to mm-hmm. me, renewal. And for yes. me, it's a time mm-hmm. to restart. It's yeah. a time yes. for renewal.
Yeah. Exactly.
So 9-10 years ago, Sister invited me on retreat. I had just became a co-worker, mm-hmm. and I didn't know what a retreat was. So I was like, okay, I mean, I'll do it.
Leap of faith.
And so uh-huh. during that weekend, I mean, it was so powerful. Uh-huh. Let me journey back. This was 9-10 years ago when I qualified for young women's retreat. I no longer qualify for young women's retreat. So I'm on retreat. I had uh-huh. an opportunity to speak to a sister, one of the mm-hmm. sisters, and it was wonderful. It was like spiritual direction. And then I went on, I went to confession, mm-hmm. and it was sort of a general confession. I mean, mm-hmm. it was long, and I was just there, able to pour out my heart and just sort of take it as far back as I remember. Mm-hmm. And the priest invited me to take advantage of Eucharistic healing. Mm-hmm. And for me, mm-hmm. that's the most powerful part of retreat for me, because it's been an opportunity to just mm-hmm. let go and just leave my baggage, if you will. Mm-hmm. I'm just able to just give it all mm-hmm. to the Lord. And mm-hmm. that's what He asks us to do, just give it back to Him. So mm-hmm. my first Eucharistic healing, I was aware that the gospel reading was going to be about the hemorrhaging woman. Mm-hmm. And I could relate, because mm-hmm. I am the hemorrhaging woman. Mm-hmm. With all my medical issues, mm-hmm. the hemorrhaging woman just spoke to me. Mm-hmm. So I remember mm-hmm. I'm at the altar, I'm mm-hmm. kneeling, and the Lord was present. He was just, I knew He was there, but I was vulnerable, I was scared, I was nervous, so mm-hmm. I'm crying. And I'm holding on to the veil, but I couldn't look up. I just couldn't. I didn't have the strength. I didn't mm-hmm. have the courage to. So fast forward to retreat number mm-hmm. two. Again, I'm the hemorrhaging woman, so I'm there, mm-hmm. and I'm just like letting it all out. Just mm-hmm. Lord, take my pain, my mm-hmm. take it all from me, because I couldn't do it myself. I didn't have the strength. I just needed the Lord to just kind of like heal me. I needed to be healed. My third retreat, Jesus told me to look up. And I was, I didn't even see the priest's face. Like, He wasn't there. He was there, but He wasn't there. I encountered Jesus. I looked in the eyes of the Lord. I was able to look up, and I saw the face of Jesus. And it's changed my whole life. It's made me who I am now, and I still am growing. Mm-hmm. And I get to go on retreat every single year, and I get mm-hmm. to reset, and I get to renew. Mm-hmm. And I'm always gonna look up now. Now I get to look up every retreat, and I look at the face of the Lord.
That was a powerful witness, you mm-hmm. know, to the presence of Jesus truly in our lives, and how much He wants to make Himself present to us. You know, it makes me think, Sister Piaju, that mm-hmm. those who are listening to this show, it would be helpful to them, I think, to have an idea of what happens on a retreat.
What a retreat looks like.
What does a retreat look like?
It sort of takes out the unknown, which allows people to enter in, I think, a little easier. Yeah. Great question, Mother. So a retreat, first thing is the primary purpose of the retreat is prayer. And so the whole retreat is structured to attempt to allow that to become something we can enter into more easily. Right. So it takes away the noise of the world. It's a good portion of the retreat is actually in silence, because it's in silence where we hear the Lord speaking to us, where we really allow Him to just love us for who we are. And that a lot of the prayer work is actually realizing we don't have to do all the work ourselves, that it's just being in His presence that is the greatest of what He really desires. And so to remind us of that, we have sisters throughout the weekend give talks that tell us the truths of who we are, which we know these things, but we always have to hear them again to actually really let them sink in and penetrate and believe. And just as Orly was describing, we have a time for a personal encounter with the Lord in what we call a Eucharistic healing service, which is a time where men and women are invited to come up to the sanctuary to kneel before our Lord as the priest brings the monstrance, which is the sort of the golden, figure that holds our blessed sacrament. And he's wearing a humeral veil, very reminiscent of the hemorrhaging woman touching the tassel. And he gives a personal benediction and comes to each of the retreatants and allows that time of prayer to really, like Orly said, to look up and to see him looking at us with love. Because he does that every day, but we don't believe it when we're in the busyness of our life. And we have that encounter that makes it real. And so it is. It's a time for sacraments, for the opportunity to go to Mass, to have that encounter in confession. And so that's what our retreat looks like. And of course, there's great food. And we say, when you're on retreat, you're not on a diet, so eat well. So yeah. So it's a beautiful weekend.
Absolutely, absolutely. You'd want every person who's a follower of Jesus Christ to have a retreat every year, once a year, wherever, with us or wherever you are, because it really changes your life. Sister, Pia Jude, Orly, thank you so very much for being with us. Jesus clearly is alive and working. We would encourage everyone to think about the retreats that we have spoken of. Join us next for our final segment, which will be on building a culture of life. Welcome back. I'm here with Sister Amata and our very dear friends and co-workers, John and Dave Ho. We're here to talk a little about building a culture of life. We know even in our own state there's been a radical turn toward death and the culture of death. Sister Amata, could you speak into that a bit?
Sure, Mother. Yes, I know, especially in New York, it seems like abortion has been a very prevalent force. In some areas, even more abortions than live births. And then recently, we've seen the passing of the new legislation in New York, the Reproductive Health Act, which has kind of essentially lifted any restrictions, even all through 9 months of pregnancy. There's also been a movement now towards passing legislation that will allow assisted suicide. And so we know that there's just so many souls out there who have been wounded by the culture of death, and it seems like many more now are being made vulnerable because of these recent developments.
What's our response, Sister, as Sisters of Life? How would you phrase that?
Well, I think this is a spiritual battle, and so our response is what it's always been, which is prayer, fasting, really pouring ourselves into that, into just imploring the Lord of Life to come. I think also just a radical solidarity with those who are vulnerable, being willing to walk with them, to journey alongside them and give them hope, realize that they're not alone. And my sense is just putting God back into the center of our culture mm-hmm. is what is going to really unify Christians, those working in the pro-life movement, mm-hmm. and build up again that sense of mm-hmm. of encouragement that this battle is mm-hmm. not over.
mm-hmm. We've had a lot of good men and women join us in this effort of building a culture of life. You are our coordinator of our co-workers who number in the thousands. Tell me about them.
Yes, sure. And we've seen a tremendous response, actually, mm-hmm. in spite of or maybe even because of this legislation, mm-hmm. even mm-hmm. more people rising up, calling us, yeah. saying, how can we get involved? What can we do? So it's been beautiful. So they're joining our already large network of lay men and women, who we call our co-workers of life, who help to support us and support our mission to pregnant women who are vulnerable, who are just in need mm-hmm. of some support, because many times they feel alone, and many times those who should be there for them maybe aren't. So our co-workers really step in to those areas practically, doing things simple, you know, mm-hmm. maybe just taking a woman out to tea, helping mm-hmm. throw her a baby shower, delivering mm-hmm. her some food or some diapers, or helping her fix up her resume just so she can find a better job, or Absolutely. Helping her move to a new apartment so she can mm-hmm. make a fresh start. Those sorts of things which really buoy her up mm-hmm. and help her realize that, mm-hmm. that she's not alone.
John and Dave, can you share a little of your experience as being our co-workers over these years?
I think we've managed to do a lot of moving for the mm-hmm. mothers. because actually part of, I think, is to give them a new life.
Yeah.
And so when we just set up the apartment, moving, mm-hmm. Getting new furniture in, we also helped them. I remember one mom, she needed to take the GED exam. It was, mm-hmm. It was like a last minute thing. And the sisters contacted us that she needed a ride. So we took her to, it was the middle of a public library in an obscure part of Queens. And so we just sat there and waited for 3 hours while she took the GED exam.
God bless
you. And then the whole time we were trying to inspire her, like, you could do this, you will pass.
Yes.
And I think she was kind of worried, but eventually she did pass, and now she's doing much, mm-hmm. much better. We took another mother to a dental appointment. Mm-hmm. I remember when she was supposed to go to a caseworker, and I think it was supposed to be a caseworker first, then the dental appointment. Uh-huh. But she said that she really had to get to the dental appointment. So we took her to the dental appointment. And I remember when she got to the back of the car, she was in so much pain. She was like, do you still want to go to the caseworker? No, I need to go home. So we took her home, made sure that she was okay. And so those are the little things uh-huh. that we're doing. And I think, but this Saturday, I think we epitomizes pretty much what we were doing. There was a mother, 7 months pregnant. She's 20 years old. And she was getting ready. The sisters were setting her up to move to Indiana. So she was going to set up a new life in Indiana. And what happened was that she had a storage unit that she needed mm-hmm. to clear out. Wow. So when we got there, there were two other co-workers already helping her sort out what she needed and what she didn't need. And so she was able to clear that out. And then once we were able to help finish with that, we took her to a nearby parish where a priest gave her a blessing. Both herself and the baby.
Beautiful.
And she said to us in the car that she had never felt so loved in her life, which struck us because she's only 20 years old. And she was so moved by that experience.
Mm-hmm. Again, that was probably the miracle that we were intended to witness, how she said that she was loved for the first time. And that's a very high, like Sister Imad was asking. Uh-huh. Well, what was that feeling like? Uh-huh. That was a high that you could never experience as a coworker.
And a reward.
Yes.
That is so powerful to be able to spiritually father a young woman like that.
Yes.
My goodness, you've had such an incredible experience. You were telling me about being at Mass one day at 5 o'clock. Tell them about that. That was hilarious and true.
It was a 5 o'clock Mass, and then in the middle of the Mass, it was during the consecration of the host, the phone was ringing. It was a text message from the sister saying that this mother is in a shelter, and she only has, she has no more diapers. You have to bring diapers to her. And I remember the priest came afterwards going, what was that phone bringing? I was going, it's the sisters. There's a mom that's in really desperate. I was going, just give me 20 minutes. I'll be there in 20 minutes. So those are the little things that I think we do. And the mom was so grateful. The mother was so grateful. Because she said she was going, I don't know how I was going to get through the weekend without
exactly.
diapers.
Exactly. Yeah. And it changes desperation into hope. Yeah. Into a sense that I'm part of something bigger, that people care about my life, you know? How amazing. Thank you. Thank you for sharing. And thank you for all you've been doing to build a culture of life alongside with us. As we end our program today, I want all those who have been listening to it, along with ourselves, to join us now in a prayer, our prayer for life. So if you will, let us pray. Eternal Father, source of life, open our hearts to see and desire the beauty of your plan for life and love. Fill us with your Holy Spirit so that our love will be generous and self-giving and we may be blessed with joy. Grant us great trust in your mercy. Forgive us for not receiving your gift of life and heal us from the effects of the culture of death. Instill in us and in all people a sense of the sacredness of every human life. Inspire our efforts to protect and care for the most vulnerable, especially women who are pregnant and their unborn children, the sick and the elderly. Strengthen us in the hope that with you nothing is impossible. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who by his cross makes all things new. Amen.
Our Lady of Guadalupe, Mother of Life,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.